So, other questions? On the sample, it has to be the same thing.
Some distance function?
When you think these links
into this maximum sample gauge,
they are always close to one of these three sample elements. So you do the projection and in the end you end up with either the trivial sample element or with one of these two non-trivial sample elements. It's the same thing. But I should say, in the case of SU3, situation is not so clear because you don't really get the full string tension, you get something less. This is what the lattice calculation show. But the projection technique is exactly the same thing. Except that you get here these two kinds of vortices which can fuse, can split, one vortex can split into two others, which I showed this morning. Because the reason is, in SU3 you have the three center elements, the trivial one, which is the unit matrix, the three-dimensional unit matrix, and then you have one which is e to the I 2 prime over 3 times the unit matrix, and the other is e to the I 4 prime over 3 times the unit matrix, which is of course the same as e to the minus I 2 prime over 3. And the important property is if you take the square of C1, you get C2. And that's why two vortices with the non-trivial center element C2, C1, can combine to a vortex with the non-trivial center element C2. Okay.
But the technique is
I have a question.
There are these absolutely fantastic results from that QCD, which has been actually done by this guy. Where is he?
Left.
By Olaf Kaczmarek.
On the potential.
So we have drawn this potential. Potential as a function of the distance. And then we have this potential, this Coulomb part. And then we have this confined sigma times r. Now, Olaf has calculated this potential for finite temperature. And then this temperature dependence is like that. You have finite temperature, and then finally you have this behavior, okay? No confinement anymore. And this is for t larger than t confined. Now, can you understand this behavior on the temperature dependence in this language which we have introduced?
I'm pretty sure.
To quantify this temperature dependence
in this model calculation.
I mean, this calculation has not been done in QCD or in SU2 gauge theory, but what we have done is we have calculated the temporal and spatial string tension as function of the temperature in the central vortex model.
Okay, you can show me the figure.
And
because this is also known.
Yeah.
This is a beautiful result also from Olaf.
Right. What you find is the following.
What is Olaf?
This is the guy, you know.
So, if you plot this as the string tension as function of the temperature.
Exactly.
What you see is the following. The temporal string tension behaves something like this. Goes to zero. It's a phase transition at some critical temperature.
Yes.
So this is sigma temporal. And now the spatial string tension. Somehow it's saturated. Goes something like that. It increases above the critical temperature. So this is what comes out from the vortex model. And I'm pretty sure if we would do the calculation in the December project, you would basically get the same result.
Have you compared this time-like string tension with Lavi's result?
Well, you see, in our case, in the sample vortex model, you have to put in the scale. And what we put in the scale was just temporal string tension at zero temperature. So the prediction basically was the behavior of the spatial string tension as function of the temperature.
I mean...
But spatial is not really interesting.
At least I don't care, okay?
Why not?
Because the time-lapse string tension is telling you something about the component.
Right, let me look. We predict this behavior, but the absolute value of your...
No, this behavior was calculated in 1984, when the first data from SU2KHT or K, they calculated the string tension as a function of temperature, okay?
Right.
In SU2KHT.
Yeah.
And you have exactly this behavior, that the string tension is going to zero at T equal to TC. Now, if you have a first order transition, I mean, there is still a long debate. What is the value of the string tension at TC? And maybe, Olaf, you could comment.
Yes, I think we calculated it in SU3 QH, I think in 96. And what we see there is very similar behavior. Then I think above TC we don't see a string tension anymore.
Yes.
We have a finite value for the string tension at TC and then it and then
in SU2 it was really like that it was going to zero.
Yes.
But in SU3
you get a finite value
some
at
finite
TC,
number
and then it's
this
gone.
Number has some meaning. Pock, do you remember the meaning of this number?
The meaning of this number
is number at TC for string tension. This was interesting physics, but I forgot.
You may relate it to the susceptibility, the final susceptibility, or it's simply that the order parameter does not, the susceptibility does not diverge for first order phase transition, unless second order phase transition susceptibility actually diverges.
Okay.
There's a finite part of first order phase transition. Yeah. And the first order, there's another susceptibility which is related to phase coexistence that makes susceptibility diverge for first order. There's a finite piece for first order, which is the string tension at TC.
Yeah. So yeah, I don't need to tell what we get out from this model. So further questions?
How does the central vortex model work at Mark 10? If you want to have vortices, nobody has looked at the knowledge.
It's a good question. So,
sorry, just a question. So, you said that when you just take central vortex configurations, then you get a string tension, right?
I mean, you see this. This is not from the props. This is not. I mean, I don't see any reason why it should not have also the vortex picture.
Yeah, I started.
Point.
I started to study this a long time ago.
Okay.
It's nice to study this.
So, further questions?
So, could you start to kind of summarize the interplay between the confinement and Carroll-Simon restoration? Do you have the same value of temperature, or do you have some expectations about the interplay and the position of this transition?
You see, the restoration of chiral symmetry at finite temperature has so far not been studied here in the center vortex picture. So far we have only studied chiral symmetry back at zero temperature.
Uh-huh.
So I can't answer this question.
Okay.
But certainly interesting project.
Yeah.
So, further questions? If not, then let's continue a little bit with something else, which I need tomorrow in my talk. I mean, depending on the time I have at the end, I will come back to the magnetic monopoles and this stuff, but at the moment, let me discuss something else. Tomorrow, I am going to discuss here a heterotonic approach to QCD. Now, a Hamiltonian approach based on canonical quantization, so what you do that we start with the wire gauge. Okay? Now, assume you are interested in the Polyakov loop. How are you going to calculate Polyakov loop in canonical formulations? Then you have wire gauge. Okay? So, an interesting question. And, the Hamiltonian approach should also somehow yield the Polyakov. So I mean, in the Hamiltonian approach, you know that your partition function is given by e to the I minus beta times the Hamiltonian. You also know you can represent this place as a function integral over the fields. In case of QCD, we have the gluon and the quark fields. Then we have here the Euclidean action, depending on all the fields. So then we have periodic boundary conditions. This is for the gauge field. They are periodic in the Euclidean time. So x4 of beta half should be equal to a nu of x4 equal to minus beta half. And we have anti-symmetric boundary condition for the quark fields. Now, the action which we have here is given by the integral over the Euclidean time, which runs from minus beta half to plus beta half, and then over the three-dimensional space. Okay, and then comes the Lagrange function, blah, blah, blah. Now, important observation is that this Lagrange function is overall invariant. Okay? Not the action, because then you have different integration domains in the time and in the space, and you have also this boundary condition. Okay? Now let's do the following. Let's exploit this O4 invariance. And let's make a change of variables. So let the x2 go to x1. X3 to x2 and x4 to x3 and then finally x1 to x4. Okay? I mean, I can make the change of variables and nothing changed if I at the same time also change my gauge field accordingly. Blah, blah, blah. And I change also the Dirac matrices. Now the Dirac matrices, Euclidean Dirac matrices, fulfill this anti-commutation relation. And in principle, I can still use the same representation as I have used before, that doesn't matter. But the problem is that I consistently make the change of variable with all the vector quantities that is with the coordinate and also with the gauge field. Now if I do this change of variables, my boundary conditions of course change. Because we had previously periodic or antiperiodic boundary conditions in X3, in X4. Now I get this condition in X3. Okay? So if I do that, I get for my partition function functional integral, and now I have boundary conditions, periodic boundary conditions, not in the X4 but in the X3 variable. Let me indicate this by index X3. And before we had these boundary conditions in X4. Okay? Then I have here in the exponent the Euclidean action where the u time runs over space. So let me restrict the extent of our spatial variables to the interval from minus n half to plus n half. Okay? So x4 goes from minus n half is plus to plus n half. Then the same is for x1 and x2. But the integral over x3 goes from minus beta half to plus beta half. I hope you can read it. Okay? So then I have the Lagrangian, which is invariant, which is basically the same Lagrangian I had before. Now what I can do, I can reverse the derivation of the function integral representation of the partition function, and I can go back now from this to the trace of e to the I. Now, my temporal, the extent of my temporal variable is no longer the inverse temperature beta, but it's now this extent of our spatial variable L. So I have traced L some new Hamiltonian, and this is still equal to my starting partition function, which I had here at the beginning. Okay? I mean, I can reverse all the transformations which lead you from here to here. Starting from this representation here, I have here the integral over the gauge field, and psi, psi, dagger. And then I end up with a Hamiltonian, H tilde, which is no longer defined on R3 as this one. Because this Hamiltonian I can write as integral over three-dimensional space some Hamiltonian density. So the integral is over R3. Now I get a Hamiltonian which looks more or less the same as the previous one. Except that the integral is now defined over S1 times R2. So I have B to X perp, and X perp refers to the two transversal coordinates, which are transversal to the third axis, which here in this case is now compact defined due to the boundary conditions I have now in the three variable. These important ones after this change here, these boundary conditions now become boundary conditions concerning X3. And then I have an additional dependence on X4, but no boundary condition on X4. Okay. So my Hamiltonian is integral over R2. Then I have the integral over X3 from minus beta half to beta half.
And now the Hamiltonian density which I have here is exactly the same I had before.
Okay? So the only difference is now that my one space axis, and I chose here the first, chosen the third spatial axis, is compactified to a circle. But the instead of the inverse temperature, which I had at the beginning in my partition function, I have now the extension over my space variable. And in fact,
what
I should take the limit where this a goes to infinity. So, is this clear up to now?
Because will be very important. Everything which comes now relies on this identity. Any question?
Excuse me, could you repeat why we should go to infinity?
Because, you see, I made the change of variables. My new x4 originally was the spatial coordinate, which extends from minus 1 L half to plus L half. And, of course, L should go to infinity if I take the sign and then infinity. So, due to this change of variables, I have now here the extent of my spatial variables,
which should go to infinity.
Okay? Now, and the Hamiltonian here is basically the same Hamiltonian density, but I integrate over R2 cross S1. And expert are the two spatial directions which are not compactified. Now,
calculating this partition function, it's the limit where A goes to infinity is rather trivial because only the ground state contributes. So in this way, I manage it.
So if I take this limit, so I'm sorry, the black box is rather small. So what I have, my original beta function, now is given by Limes, it goes to infinity, raise e to the minus L times L tilde. Now this is Limes, L goes to infinity, the sum of all eigenstates times L, and that's where En are the eigenvalues of my Hamiltonian H tilde. Right? And in this limit, this is given by, let me write it that way, e to the minus L times the lowest eigenvalue of this Hamiltonian H tilde. So what I've basically managed is I have expressed the partition function of my system through the ground state energy of my system. However, I have to calculate these eigenvalues not on R3, but on R2 cross S1 of beta. Okay? Any question? So, I mean, this is another, I think, smart way to express the partition function, because you have to find only one eigenvalue, but you have to find it on this partially compactified spatial manifold. So this manifold now replaces R3, which we had at the beginning. Okay? Now I can derive from this partition function the pressure energy density in the usual way, because this is still equal to my initial partition function, which I have erased. Taking derivatives with respect to beta, and so on. I can also introduce here a chemical potential. And then, of course, if I introduce a chemical potential, I have to be careful because I have changed or I have traded x4 or the time for one spatial dimension. So my chemical potential will show up in the Hamiltonian no longer in the usual way, but in a different way. And it will come with the third gamma matrix if I compactify the third dimension. So if I include the chemical potential, if you do carefully the change of variables, what you then find is the following. I should have it somewhere here. Let's denote that this Hamiltonian is the U, the way this one was V into 0. And then comes I and U, and now we have the fermion fields. Let me denote this measure on this compactive, partially compactified manifold in the short notation as sub beta dx3h. Okay. Then we have here our Hamiltonian, which we had before here, this one. And then we get the extra term from the chemical potential, which is given by this measure with the third axis extending from minus beta to plus beta half. And then we have here the fermion field. Then comes the Dirac matrix alpha 3 and psi, and that's it. So I can exactly reformulate. My finite temperature theory with a compactified spatial dimension. I have boundary conditions, periodic and anti-periodic boundary conditions in this compactified spatial dimensions, and I take this limit where this new inverse temperature goes to infinity. So now I can use this report to calculate the Polyakov limit. So I will show tomorrow. Today here in this exercise, let me show how to get the pressure of free gas of bosons or fermions from this formula, this expression. Because you need there some mathematical tricks, otherwise we will never arrive at the correct form of the pressure or energy density. So let me do the following. Let me forget at the moment about the chemical potential. We can include the chemical potential later if we like. Let me just consider the case of zero chemical potential, and we know the partition function is then given by e to the I, this ground state energy calculated on this spatial manifold. So let me write this energy by introducing a quotation mark energy density, which I call little e, by taking off the volume of this spatial manifold. So our spatial extension was L, then this gives the volume L square, and this is the circle which has the length beta. So the volume of this partially compactified manifold is L squared times beta. So let me take this out, L squared times beta, and the rest I define as one. Let me call it pseudo energy density, because it's not the real energy density. Now it's a rather trivial calculation, calculating the pressure and the true energy density from this quantity. I mean, you know how the pressure is defined in the first place and the energy density, dividing this log from this by the volume and taking the derivative of the log of the partition function with respect to beta. So what you find then is that the pressure is given by minus this pseudo energy density, and the true energy density is given by the derivative. And let me look it up not to make a mistake with the. So, what you get then is the derivative with respect to beta of beta times E. And if you have a chemical potential, then you get another term minus the chemical potential with the derivative with respect to u. Now what you calculate in this way are really the usual pressure and the usual energy density which you would derive from your partition function in the first place. Okay? So now let me calculates this quantity for a free gas of bosons or fermions. Okay. And I'm working here on the Hamilton. Yeah, please.
I have a question. Yeah. Because, I mean, the pressure you calculate by taking log of Z and taking derivative with respect to volume.
Yeah.
And your energy density can depend on volume.
Yeah.
So this formula which you have written,
yeah, this is in the case.
Only valid if you have ideal gas.
Right, if I ignore the volume dependence, you're right.
If you ignore the volume dependence.
No, absolutely right. I mean, I did here some simplification because I want to
do
the calculation.
But you're right.
I mean, there is a principle of volume dependence, and you have to,
in a
realistic system with interaction, you have to include this.
Exactly.
Absolutely. Thank you. So, I mean, let's calculate this quantity. So what is the energy density in a, let's say, free gas of bosons or fermions? If you have fermion, bosons, the energy density is basically given by the constant energy and taking off the volume. What you find then is 1/2 integral over the momentum of the momenta, speed energy momenta. Let me put here a beta, and then you have here the dispersion relation. So for a massive boson, this omega would be something like square root of m squared plus p squared. Now we are on R2 cross S1 of beta. So I mean this integral measure is defined by
if you go to Fourier space,
also in Sandow was a much smaller frequency. It's given by one over beta. Sandow was a much smaller frequency. And you have the integral over the momenta, two momenta, corresponding to the two non-conductive dimension. And that's it. Okay. Well, maybe I write it in the way beta prop and omega 1. N is the Matsubara frequency. Now the for bosons, the Matsubara frequency is 2 pi n over
beta.
Right. So when rather in principle there is a factor of 2 pi cube included, let me put here the bar, and the bar I define as usual by d over 2 pi. Okay? So now if I take this here on this conductified manifold, this omega of p prop and omega n sub Matsubara frequency is given by m squared plus p prop squared plus sub Matsubara frequency squared.
Okay.
Now, according to what I have derived before, the negative of this quantity should be the pressure. Okay? Now, this quantity doesn't look like the pressure at all.
Not at all.
Not at all, right. So, first of all, this integral is not well defined. This is divergent. This does not exist as the way it is written down here.
We have to make some mathematical gymnastics to make this expression well defined.
You should get some log algorithm.
Not in the Hamiltonian approach. I mean, you can.
I'm not in the Hamiltonian.
I'm in the Hamiltonian approach, and you see the energy is pretty easy. I mean, if you have a degeneracy factor, I can add it here. A degeneracy factor, if you like, for the two photons, for example, I have two polarization for the photon, and get a another factor of 2. So, okay, but in principle, what I should calculate this quantity, which is ill-defined at the moment. So, the first thing I'm doing is I do a Poisson conservation. Okay? So, the Poisson. I mean, you know all this formula. I don't know it really by heart. But if I have a sum from minus to plus infinity e to the I and x, then it's something like sum of k from minus infinity to plus infinity, and then I guess comes the factor of pi, and then comes delta of x minus 2 pi k. So what is the Poisson formula? I assume we have not the sum here but an integral. Then it would be the Fourier representation of the delta function. But since you have integer here, this function is periodic in x. So the right hand side is also to be periodic in x. And the periodicity you get by summing over all these delta functions is this repeated in x. Okay? This is the Vernon Poisson formula. Okay? Now, I use this formula to calculate here the sum of the Matsubara frequencies. So what I want, what I need, and how much time did I do so far?
You have 20 minutes left.
Oh my God. But I mean, it's really lost why I do the calculations and not just quote the result. So, what we basically have to calculate is 1 over beta, sum over all the Matsubara frequencies, form a function of the Matsubara frequencies. So what I do, I write this first as 1 over beta, sum over all n, and then integral dz from minus is plus infinity from some delta function, z minus omega n, and then I have f of, wait a second, f of z. Okay? That's an identity. Okay? Yeah. Now I use for this sum, I use the Poisson summation formula. I mean, this omega n here, this omega n was 2 pi m over beta. If I take out this beta here from the delta function, I have precisely the argument that you have here. Okay? And then I get basically this sum. I replace this sum by this sum. And what I find then here for the sum over the Matsubara frequencies, the factor beta goes away again, this beta. In the end, you find 1 over 4 pi integral dz f of z from minus to plus infinity, and then the sum over k from minus to plus infinity e to the I k beta times z. So, some of the Matsubara frequencies you can write as this after Poisson deformation in this kind of sum. Now, what we are interested in are these three-dimensional integral, is this sum over the Matsubara frequencies included of any function of e perp and omega n. Now, if you apply this formula, you have to add also the integrals of the two transverse dimensions, and I can rename this integral, this variable z, I can rename to p3. So then I get all together the three-dimensional momentum integral over the flat momentum space, because the two transverse dimensions are flat, and this is also an integration which goes from minus to plus infinity. And then I find here f of p perp and p3 times sum over k from minus to plus infinity. And I have here this e k beta times p3. Now let's take one term which is k equal to 0, the k equal to 0 term. Then this is the 1. And what is then left is just the usual three-dimensional integral over the, not compactified space. So this is the corresponding integral at zero temperature. And by skipping the k equal to zero term, I remove the zero temperature term, which is biologically field theory, of course. So after Poisson deformation, I can easily extract the zero temperature part. So then I'm left with the summation over k non-equal to zero, and I got already rid of some divergences. Now I apply this here to this integral here. Okay. Still, wie gesagt, the integrals are not yet mathematically well defined. So what I have obtained so far is e of beta equals the integral over the three-dimensional momentum space, flat momentum space. I have this symmetry factor, this is 1/2, and then I have the omega, which was the square root omega of p perp and p3. And I have this sum e to the I k with k not equal to zero from beta and p3. Now the next thing I do, the omega was here the square root. I now represent the square root by a proper time integral. It's again something which seems to be trivial,
but it's not trivial at all.
For the following reason, I think I can erase here this Poisson conservation. Oh, let me keep this omega.
Can you show the previous board for a second?
Yeah, sure. Okay, so the result we got here, the integral of the usual three-dimensional flat space of the energy with this additional sum over these oscillating terms with k not equal to 0. Okay? So now we represent the omega by a proper time integral. So what I'm using, if I have a quantity A of some power mu, I write this as 1 over gamma function of minus mu integral d tau, tau 1 minus mu. E to the minus tau times A. So now comes the integration limits.
In principle, I should let this lower limit go to zero in order to get the gamma function. Otherwise, I get the incomplete gamma function.
However, what you see here is this integral is not defined at the lower limit. If I go to zero,
so I should take some
limit epsilon. However, I'm cheating here because if I derive this representation, I have to start from the incomplete gamma function, and what I get then, I get 1 over 1 gamma of minus mu. And then I have here the epsilon times the quantity A, which I would like to calculate, and I get about 0. So of course, I mean, this formula is useless.
Because I have the quantity I want to calculate here in the integration limit. And I have it here in the incomplete gamma function. And furthermore, I should take the limit of course out.
This limit
does actually not exist.
If you take the incomplete gamma function of a negative index here and let the argument go to zero, it blows up. But what exists is the complete gamma function of, let's say, minus 1/2.
Now, the funny point is, the reason why you can use this representation and eventually let this limit go to zero is
when you use this formula and you integrate, perform the integration over the momentum, then this proper time integral becomes
well defined, you can take the limit.
Okay? So, how much time do I have left?
10 minutes.
Oh my God. So let's use this representation for omega. I write omega as omega square root. I use this formula for mu equal to 1/2. And then I get this omega in the exponent square.
And I get the p prop plus p3
squared for my pseudo energy density. I have this symmetry factor 1/2, I have this three-dimensional integral, I have now a Gaussian integral which I can take, and I have in addition this
time and declare that we leave out here the lower limit with tau to the -1, -1/2, and I forgot the 1/1 gamma of -1/2. So, and oh my god, I forgot something else. Tau to the -1, -1/2, and I have the sum over k not equal to 0, e to the I k beta times p3. Now I have here just ordinary Gaussian integrals which I can take. Okay? I carry out the Gaussian integrals, and then I can also carry out the proper time integral. And what I obtain in the end then is the usual expression for the negative of the pressure. Now there is one thing more. So I mean this Gaussian integral everybody can take. Actually I forgot you also this mass term, there's also this m squared. And if you have a mass term, actually you can't do the integral as a proper time integral exactly. You can express it in terms of the modified Bessel function. But if you limit where m goes to 0, you can of course carry out all the calculations. Now, what you find then is the following for the pseudo energy density. You get you get -8π² sum over n from -1 to infinity, and then you have n over n beta to the power 2, and then we get the modified Bessel function of n beta and n. Now you know this.
Could you show it down?
Yeah, sorry. You know this modified Bessel function in the limit where the argument goes to 0, which is the case which we need for n equal to 0. And what is left then is the sum over n, which you can express in terms of the theta function. What you find then in the end for this pseudo energy density is minus n over π² times the theta function of 4 times beta inverse to the 4. Now when you use the value of the beta function, for the theta, Riemann theta function, which is pi to the 4 over 19, then you get exactly, when you take the negative of that, remember p was minus this energy density, then you get exactly the Stefan Boltzmann law.
No, there is a factor of p to the 4 missing.
No, this is 1 over beta to the 4.
Aha, beta to the 4.
Yeah. So you get precisely the Stefan Boltzmann law, the correct thermodynamic pressure. And remember, I started from the expression for this pseudo energy density in the Hamiltonian bulge, symmetry factor over 2. So I calculate just the ordinary energy. Of course, you need here some tricks, but in the end, you recover the correct thermodynamics. So there are two important steps here. First, I did Poisson summation, which allows me to eliminate the zero temperature term, which is divergent. And the second was I represent this omega or this clear as a proper time integral. And after that I can carry out all the momentum integral. And after I have done this, I can also carry out the proper time integral and then I'm done. Now you can use this also for a Fermi system with fine mechanical potential and get the correct thermodynamics. Now, this approach you can now use to calculate the Polyakov loop in the Hamiltonian approach.
because you have interchanged the world of time and space. Okay, and the what you consider then is the Polyakov loop, not along the time axis, but along this compactified spatial axis. So we consider then the Polyakov loop as this trace passed over product into the I integral dx3 from minus beta r to beta r from a3. Okay? So that's the way how you can calculate the Polyakov loop also in the Hamiltonian approach. So, questions? I mean, it was a little bit technically, but I think for the exercises, I think the exercise, I think, should include also some calculus. Yeah, I mean, I'm going to use this tomorrow in the next part of the lecture.
Okay. Time is over. We've still got 4 minutes, so okay. I guess that's a good time for any further discussion. Wait for the mic.
So, if you once more find out how this vacuum divergence was removed, what was this step?
First, I did the Poisson observation.
Yeah.
And when it turns out in this Poisson sum, the term with n equal to 0 is just zero temperature expression for the energy density. This I can then easily eliminate by excluding this term. Then I can put a value of some divergent pieces. The rest is still not well defined. I use them in the proper time, kind of regularization if you like. And then I can carry out the random integrals and the proper time integral that also exists.
But I mean, this has this E has an interpretation of the energy density. Not the pressure, okay? I mean, the pressure, of course, I have this divergence, so I have this infinity. But in energy density, I don't have this divergence.
No, the energy density I got by taking the derivative of the pseudo energy density with respect to beta.
Okay.
As I showed in the.
Yes. So there is this divergence is just a constant, which is not contributing to the energy density.
No, I mean, you have to take it out, I mean, if you are in the sum, it's actually interesting. Right.
Okay.
So, I mean, now the point is, what I want to stress here is that by doing a Poisson transformation, you separate the zero temperature part explicitly.
Okay.
Yeah. Or easily, you can remove it very easily. Because otherwise, you have to make some subtraction and so on. So here to get it basically for free.
At the moment it looks as very a non-economical method. Okay?
No, it's very economical because you need only the ground state to get the partition function.
But if I would calculate this example in the standard way, this is much simpler.
I'm not sure. I mean, you make a loop calculation, of course, it's not complicated. I mean, it's but also, we have the same problems in the standard calculation, the standard loop calculation.
Okay, I mean, with this divergence, yes, but.
I mean, you have also to remove the divergence there. No, but look, I mean, it's completely not obvious that from this expression you will.
No, this was absolutely not obvious. It's very interesting calculations, but. I mean,
you think it's not economic?
I think it's not economic, and if you show me that this approach is really very helpful to get the Polyakov loop.
Yeah,
I would say it's very interesting, okay?
No, I'm using it precisely to get the
problem. It's very nice. But to calculate thermodynamics,
I
prefer to do it in the standard way.
Okay, I mean, because we are used to the standard way,
yeah,
of course.
Exactly.
The same thing, you can include the chemical potential even. I mean, if you want to have the energy density, as I pointed out at the beginning, you have to take the derivative with respect to beta and to the chemical potential. But you get it also from this. I mean, the only difference is that, of course, you have these fermionic Mantovani frequencies, which are 2n plus 1 times pi over beta. This is extra piece.
But you can do everything. You need an
extra shift in your integration variable, which I call z. But everything works out in the same way.
The Poisson preservation works in the same way.
I guess it's time for coffee break, and so let's stand up.